Hey guys, so in this video I want to talk about Splinter Cell Blacklist, which I played on my PlayStation 3 a little about a month ago or so, maybe even less time, even less while ago, I don't know, but I'm a huge Splinter Cell fan, so I pretty much played every single Splinter Cell game, so I had to finally get my hands on this one. And now I want to get out of the way first that, like all other games in the franchise, storytelling is the weakest aspect of Splinter Cell Blacklist, especially near the end. It just derails into cuts of, you know, antiquated spy thriller tropes. You know what I'm talking about. You know, the hero pulls a Trojan horse to get close to the enemy, and the villain ultimately delivers a very tired monologue, only to get shot and have his ankle cut. You know, James Bond films in the 70s have done better than this, time and time again. The premise is that there's this elite international group of terrorists who are so adept, who are so skilled, that they can pull off massive terror attacks every week. The terrorists call themselves the Engineers. Their demand is for the United States to pull out its military troops from all other countries. And until the United States does so, every week they will continue to pull off terrorist attacks throughout the world. It's clear from the beginning of the game that the terrorists aren't bluffing. It's also clear that only Sam Fisher's elite team of analysts and operatives are competent and wily enough to respond appropriately. Well, that's true most of the time, because even this newly formed fourth echelon gets duped constantly. The Engineers is like the ultimate terrorist group, and to the very end, they carry out ridiculously massive attacks, which the fourth echelon and Sam Fisher only barely manages to stop at the very last minute. I really don't like to describe the storytelling here as being cartoony, because that probably does cartoons a lot of disservice, but in any case, its wacky narrative is a jarring match to a serious atmosphere. In contrast to the game's ridiculous premise, the atmosphere is perfectly serious, so decidedly a spy thriller. For me, it's hard to think of any other game that actually makes me feel like I'm a real-life badass covert operative. I feel like Jason Bourne as he was intended to be before the events of the first movie. Splinter Cell Blacklist situates Sam Fisher and sometimes his partner Briggs all around the globe, in over 20 countries in fact, to deal with the terrorist threat in a way no other government agency can. While I personally missed a narratively simple and consistent third echelon, there's no denying the thrilling sensation of being the man of a rogue anti-terrorist arm accountable only to the President of the United States, and sometimes, though the President would disagree, accountable to nothing but the mission at hand. This is why I wanted to start talking about the game story before I talked about anything else. Previous Splinter Cell games just did not try to make the story matter so much. I mean, well, by previous, I'm not including Conviction, as that had Sam Fisher getting embroiled in a massive intergovernmental conspiracy, all the while finding out the true status of his daughter, Sarah. That was like Ubisoft trying to rip off 24. At least Blacklist doesn't make the mistake of focusing so much on Sam Fisher as a character, trying to mold him into being a video game version of Jack Bauer, but storytelling of past Splinter Cell games weren't so grandiose, and in my opinion, their stories were better for it. The espionage action in Splinter Cell is unlike any other in that they feel so plausible and real life, and Blacklist does an amazing job of capturing that Splinter Cell spirit, a fantastic achievement that gets marred by hectic jumble of ridiculous terrorist group outsmarts terrorizes everyone story premise. I would probably rank Splinter Cell Conviction as the worst game in the series. And that's why from the onset, I was really skeptical of this follow-up. I will now admit that skepticism was misplaced, actually. It's surprising because the traces of Conviction are everywhere in this game. Sam can insta-kill with the mark and execute mechanic, that's from Conviction. When Sam runs away after being discovered, the enemies will converge toward the location where Sam was last seen, also from Conviction. And Sam has an arsenal of very loud weapons and explosives to choose from. And also, the really cool thing that returns is, you know, you can go from cover to cover the way that Splinter Cell Conviction does, which I always thought was really cool. Yet, all these aspects from Conviction actually enhance the game experience. I don't quite understand how Ubisoft has managed to make me love everything I once hated back in Conviction, but to their credit, Blacklist is the first and still the only Splinter Cell game in which the game is thrilling to play stealthily and actually enjoyable to shoot and blast your way out of really hairy situations. I think this is because as much as Blacklist retains the action aspects of the prequel, it doesn't neglect its roots. Unlike Conviction, Blacklist understands what Splinter Cell is about. The goggle, the silent and non-lethal weaponry, the gadgets, and the multiple ways to sneakily overcome well-equipped and suspecting enemies. Hiding in the shadows and knocking out enemies out, or killing them if you prefer, was never as good as this. I have great love and adoration for the classic Splinter Cell Chaos series, and I realize this might sound blasphemous to a hardcore Splinter Cell fan, but Splinter Cell Blacklist outranks it in most respects. In immersion, gameplay, fluidity, amount of content, and replayability. Sure, Chaos Theory has Michael Ironside's badass voice acting and its memorable level design, but for me, at the end of the day, those seem like minor advantages to a game that has the upper hand on everything else. As usual though, I will have to do some nitpicking here. The body armored enemies in this game are ridiculous. They are immune to headshots with their damn bulletproof helmets, and they can't be attacked from the front. And they can survive an explosion. You throw a grenade at them, they'll come right back up. The only weapon that can take down these fuckers in one hit are incendiary grenades. Splinter Cell games pride themselves in not having bosses and being realistic, but these overpowered enemies are a bit too much if you ask me. On the one hand, I like the challenge that these baddies offer, but more often than not, their existence in this game just makes me feel frustrated. They can be such a chore, especially in parts where the game's objective is to eliminate all enemies. They also really hamper co-op missions, especially when I end up with an online co-op partner who prefers to go guns blazing than do things stealthily, and that's most online players. Then there's the goggles. See, the night vision goggles are normally the trademark gadget of a Splinter Cell game. Without those three green lights adorning Sam Fisher's forehead, a Splinter Cell game just doesn't feel like a Splinter Cell game. When Double Agent had too many moments in which Sam couldn't use his goggles, I felt frustrated. But at least it wasn't like Conviction, in which Sam doesn't even get to don the goggles until halfway into the game. Fortunately, in Blacklist, the goggles are a staple of the gameplay, all except for one level that takes place in Guantanamo Bay. I'm not without gripes though, because in Blacklist, the goggles can be a hassle to use. In previous Splinter Cell games, Sam could switch to different modes of the goggles with the push of a button. And each mode, you know, night vision, thermal vision, electronic vision, were useful for particular situations. In Blacklist though, there are only two modes, sonar vision and night vision, and selecting between the two requires me to hold up on the D-pad on my controller and press the triangle button. And I found that to be a little bit more annoying than usual. I guess I'm just very disappointed that night vision goggles aren't all that useful in this game. For the most part, I was either not using the goggles at all or briefly equipping the sonar vision goggles. In normal difficulty, the sonar goggles can see through walls, and you can see enemies through the walls. And it visually outlines everything important, like enemies who are far away, vents, stuff to climb. I read some user reviews lamenting how these sonar goggles break the game because it reveals too much, but I usually play Splinter Cell games on the highest difficulty setting or high difficulty setting, so I don't really have that complaint. In the highest difficulty setting, the sonar goggles cannot see through the walls, and that alone makes the goggles a more tense stealth experience. I'm just nostalgic for the days when Sam's green goggles actually had constant utility from beginning to end. Sneaking in the dark, seeing the gritty world of espionage professional and either through black and white lens or through green tinted lens, that was something I could experience so well only through Splinter Cell games. To be deprived of that left me feeling a bit bummed. Oh, and about Sam's new voice actor. It's a shame, really. Going by the story, this is the oldest version of Sam Fisher we've been exposed to, and yet his voice in Blacklist is so young and so cocky. Even in Conviction, the worst Splinter Cell game, the badassery of Sam Fisher naturally flowed out of Michael Ironside's gruff, intimidating threats. The new voice actor, in contrast, sounds like an everyday spy, and though he's gone through a lot, still too inexperienced to be the badass that Sam Fisher is supposed to be. I go into Splinter Cell games with low expectations for the story, but I thought I could at least always rely on getting attached to the character of Sam Fisher. I wouldn't blame it solely on the new voice actor, as the writing itself is largely at fault, but I finished the game thinking the protagonist could be anyone. It could have been anyone. I wouldn't have cared if it was Sam Fisher or Archer or Kestrel. It really wouldn't have made that much of a difference. Well, I suppose one thing missing would be the unnecessary phone calls to Sam's daughter, Sarah. Ugh. My nitpickings aside, and the ridiculously bad storytelling aside, I have to say that Splinter Cell Blacklist delivers. Yes, this is what I want out of a modern Splinter Cell game. Sneaking past hapless guards in the dark, and getting to use all manners of high-tech gadgetry and the skilled maneuvers of a legendary operative to do so. There are multiple ways to tackle each situation, and the locations Sam Fisher ends up in are those real-world spy locations that's hard not to fantasize about. The game has a great amount of content as well, complementing the well-paced single-player campaign are a good number of cooperative missions and side missions, and a unique online multiplayer mode Splinter Cell fans know as Spies vs. Mercs. It's all here in one awesome package, and why I end up feeling like this is the best Splinter Cell game made thus far.